Salutations, celestial sightseers. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky for the week of June 25th through July 1st. Let's see what's up this week. A spotlight on Lyra and the moon makes several stellar stops. Last week we found the most prominent summer stars and constellations. Now let's start with the first one from that episode, looking halfway up the horizon, towards the east-northeast, about an hour after sunset, at Vega. This star anchors Lyra the Harp, a constellation with some dim stars shaped like a parallelogram. But first, a short detour into astronomy theater.
Lyra represents the musical instrument of Orpheus from Greek mythology, and there are many musical and artistic references to this figure. Have you ever been to an Orpheum theater?
Named for him!
Orpheus played beautiful music with his lyre, but due to an extended period of mourning for his late wife, he spurned the advances of the beautiful women of Thrace, his home, who were enraged when he ignored them. They tried to kill him, but even arrows and knives stopped upon reaching his beautiful music. After shrieking loudly, his music was finally overpowered, and they tore him limb from limb, tossing his lyre into the sea, which ultimately the gods retrieved and subsequently placed in the heavens for us to view.
Okay, back to the sky. Lyra is small, and much of it can be seen in simple binoculars, even if parts or most of it is invisible to the naked eye from your location. Use binoculars to observe these three stars near to Vega here. This one, Delta Lyrae, is immediately split into two stars when magnified slightly using binoculars. And note the color difference. This indicates some interesting science occurring. The reddish star is Delta 2 and is an M-class star, therefore relatively cool around 3,500 Kelvin. It's about 900 light-years away. The bluish-white star, Delta 1, is a spectral class B star almost 1,100 light-years away from Earth and is much hotter, hence the bluer color. There are a lot of other double stars to be found in the diminutive Lyra, and they are not hard to find from Vega, even if light pollution washes out most of the constellation's stars. We'll look at this part of the sky a few times over the course of the summer. If you want a head start, though, head to eyesonthesky.com and download the free Lyra star chart I created with several binocular and telescopic objects that are easy to find. This week, the moon makes some visits to planets and celestial sights along the ecliptic. Starting on the 25th, the waxing crescent moon is less than a fist width away from the red planet of Mars. This will make a nicer naked eye view than telescopic, as Earth is far outpacing Mars around the sun, and its angular diameter is quite small presently, at just under 7 arc seconds, a tiny disk in most any telescope. But 2 days later, the first quarter moon forms a lovely triangle with Saturn and Spica, the brightest star in Virgo. If you didn't spot the craters on the moon relating to historical figures of the Venus transit from the May 28th Eyes on the Sky, be sure to review that for more information on it. And finally, on the 30th, the moon slips into Scorpius, just 7 degrees from the red star Antares we talked about last week. So if you weren't sure where to find it, look near the moon on the 30th. There are some telescopic globular clusters in this area, M4 and M80, but you will want to wait at least a week or two so moonlight doesn't interfere with trying to locate and observe them. The low incline of the ecliptic may cause Mercury to be hard to see in the atmospheric muck of twilight, but the stars of Castor and Pollux form a twilight trio with it that may help you find the fleet-footed planet. Just don't confuse the stars for the rocky body that's orbiting our sun. That leaves the morning planets with their own trio, but in this case only one star and two planets. Look for Jupiter with Venus below it. And closest to the horizon, just before the sun brightens the sky, you may spy Aldebaran in Taurus. These make for great photographic opportunities, See what you can capture. Last week, the American Medical Association adopted policies based on a report indicating links to light at night with breast cancer and other circadian disruptions. Let's all work to reduce excessive and misaimed light at night, not only to see more stars, but for our own health and well-being. Also, thanks for your donations that allow Eyes on the Sky to stay ad-free. So keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down by using dark sky-friendly lighting fixtures so we can all see what's up.